Greetings, Tezos Nation. Welcome to another edition of TezTalks Live. I'm Stu from the Tezos Commons. Joining me today is Damien Patero, co-founder and CEO of Lyzi. Lyzi, for those who might not know, is the app that lets consumers pay for purchases with their crypto and provides an end-to-end, fully regulated platform that allows brands and merchants to adopt crypto payments smoothly and seamlessly. On today's stream, we'll be giving away four Lyzi token packages containing 2,000 Lyzi tokens each to four of our lucky viewers. If you'd like one of those lucky viewers to be you, keep an ear out for a keyword later on during the stream. Then comment with the keyword below this video where it's posted by the @TezosCommons account on X. Hi, Damien. Where are you right now and how is the weather?
Hello, guys. I'm in Paris, actually, and it's pretty gloomy today. Yeah, it was not so good. So, yeah.
Fair enough. To get the ball rolling, can you tell us a little bit about your background and your personal journey into the exciting world of blockchain technology?
Yeah, sure. First of all, want to thank you for inviting me here, and it's always a pleasure to share, our experiences and how it works. So basically, I'm in the industry since 2017 because I had one of my previous shareholders that was talking about something called Bitcoin at that time. I remember he was pretty freaked out when it, took 20% up every day. You know, it was just a crazy moment for him, but you know, I was not impressed by that, but more by the blockchain technology. This is how I came into it, actually. And in 2019, I decided to build an on-chain solution built on Algorand blockchain. It was not on Tezos. That's the next story. And that's it came up with a loyalty on-chain solution called Feedly, actually, that was enabling people to do loyalty token swap, basically, you know, in merchants. And that's it. It came, yeah, actually. But more globally, otherwise, I'm just an entrepreneur since 12 years now in different industries like retail, like tech, and blockchain now, of course. And it's a passion for me to be here and to build products.
Fantastic. And this journey, of course, has led you to becoming co-founder and CEO of Lyzi, which I briefly introed off the top there, but can you expand a little bit on exactly what Lyzi is and what your team's vision is for it?
Yeah, I will give you a bit of the story of the how. I told you about this loyalty on-chain solution called Feedly at the very beginning, but the entire story is more based with Tezos because we've been building in the Tezos ecosystem since 2019 because one of my partners, my main partner called Sebastian, built in 2019 a solution called Easy Wallet. It was the first crypto payment solution, non-custodial solution built on the Tezos blockchain and Bitcoin. This solution was connecting at that time in France with 27,000 point of sales, actually. And when we met in 2020+1, we decided to merge our both solution, Feedly, this loyalty thing that was on the Algorand blockchain, and this non-custodial wallet, crypto payment wallet called Lyzi Wallet. And that's how Lyzi came up in 2022, actually, with the merge of those two solutions. So now what's Lyzi? So Lyzi is just the aggregate of those two solutions, but if we can define it in one word, not one word, but in several words, but make it quick, it's just a crypto payment hub connecting brands on the first hand with Web3 users that got their crypto on fully regulated platform, actually. This is how it works. Yeah, this is what is Lyzi right now. And we are, maybe if you want, maybe we are mainly based in France, actually. That's our number one country, of course, because we are all from France, and this is where everything began. We are developing and pushing the pace, accelerating it in Europe, actually. Yeah.
Perfect. So you've been hard at work making crypto payments a reality for quite some time now, beginning with the Easy Wallet, as you mentioned. Can you walk us through the journey to bringing Lyzi to the masses so far?
Yeah, I mean, it was not an easy journey, as you said, because, you know, in 2019 here in France, since we are a French-based solution, we had to deal with regulation. We had the regulation at we were maybe the first or one of the first country to have a crypto regulation, actually. So in 2019, it was a pretty tough for us to deal with it. However, you know, even at that time, I thought that, you know, this was an opportunity because if we want to have like a mass adoption, you know, in the market, you need to have like a regulation. This is, you know, like the deal you need to have. Otherwise, it won't work. It will work at the beginning, but it will stop, you know, at one point. So, yeah. So regulation arrived in 2019. And we had like to experiment other way of dealing with the product, actually. So the first product was mainly based on this non-custodial thing. We had at the second level to do a KYC, but doing a KYC on non-custodial was a bit tough for the audience we had at that time. And we also had like some, you know, like technological issues, of course, because, you know, blockchain is still early. Let's call it like this. And, you know, when we do crypto payment, above all in POS system, in real life with real people and real brands, it can be tough sometimes because you have to deal with refund, with reverts. And yeah, we had to learn about, you know, all those feedbacks we had from brands and the end users as well. And that's, it came up to aggregate on the first hand, you know, those, you know, like exchanges that are fully regulated now, mainly based in Europe. I will call it like this. I mean, at least the exchanges that are fully regulated here in Europe to start with. And on the other hand, we had the brands, and the brands were pretty tough in 2017, 18, you know, like we had a lot of evangelization, you know, democratization, learnings to give them because they were not mature at all on what was the technology, how to use it. You know, everything was a bit tricky when we were dealing about the how we will make it, you know, because usually, you know, when we talk with brands, the innovation labs are just, okay, let's do it. It's insane. You have a great solution with a great product. But when you deal, you know, with the financial department or when you deal with the legal, that's how it came up to be a little bit more tricky. So that's how we came up with this product, actually, that fits, you know, really, you know, like the brands as the end users. That's very important if you want to have usage.
Okay. And why is enabling crypto payments in the retail sector and enabling crypto payments with brands, why is that a priority in your eyes?
I mean, it's three pillars on that, in my opinion. You know, the first pillar is mainly based on the Web3 ecosystem. If we want to have, you know, global democratization and other use cases than just speculation, we need to have merchants that master this acceptance, you know. And I'm sure we will talk about debit and credit card right after, but in my opinion, they are imperfect because, you know, when you pay, for example, where your Gnosis Pay card, for example, with Visa MasterCard, the merchant doesn't know that finally you pay with crypto, which is a pain point in my opinion, because if we want to have global usage and global democratization, you're gonna need to have merchants that know that they are cashing out, you know, some cryptos, you know, and that's very important. So the approach we are having right now with merchants is more about this omnichannelity thing, you know, which is very important for them because it's just a new ways of acquiring new customers. That's very important. And, you know, for example, I got some digits, you know, like stats. In France, we have 10% of the people that got crypto. That's the real fact, you know. You need to be able, you know, to talk to those people because they are 10% of the population, you know. So it's not just 1 or 2%, you know. It's not just like anarchist people or whatever, you know. No, now you have a lot of people that got them. And the pain point they are having is to re-inject them in the real economy. So if you accept this way of payment, you will get a new audience, new consumers that got money. Above all, when it's the beginning of the bull run, as you can see, as we can see now. And, you know, all those people, we want to re-inject, you know, their crypto in the real economy. So for merchants, it's very important to master that. And as a second step, that's how we onboard them in the, you know, in the Web3 space, because we believe that, you know, this first step has to be the plug and play possible, the easiest way for them. You know, it needs to be plug and play. We are already connecting to the POS system or the hardware payment terminals. That's very important because they don't have to deal with integrations. Very important. Second step, we cover regulation. We aggregate fully regulated platforms. So don't, we are very careful with that. Regulators are here. So you be safe. The people that are spending their crypto, they are all whitelisted. And the third point is this marketing thing where, you know, they drive a new community and they will go as a second step, for example, into loyalty, into, for example, treasury management when they will cash their first crypto in their ledger, for example. So, you know, it's a step-by-step thing we need to go. And we believe crypto payment is the first step as we are building it right now. Yeah.
Okay. And obviously, it's a very important use case. And as you say, makes things real in a different way than what people in this space have experienced before. And I'm curious about your decision to do it here in the Tezos ecosystem. I know you mentioned a little bit earlier how you sort of got intro'd to Tezos, but what made you decide that the Tezos ecosystem was the right place to realize your vision for Lyzi?
I mean, you know, you talk about, you know, like the payment use case, it's the start of pretty much everything. You know, when you read the Bitcoin white paper, the only thing is peer-to-peer payment. I mean, this is what it should be. So what's important for us, because we are dealing with POS systems and real people in real life, you know, is to have this technology that will be the scalabliest possible. That's very important, and the cheapest possible, because, you know, like payment is so challenging for us. I mean, Stu, I'm sure you love to pay with your cell phone, you know, with this tap and pay thing. It's just a second to have it done, you know. So it's so challenging to have something that is the easiest possible for the end user, as it should be for the brands. So we need to have the technology. We believe Tezos got a strong technology that is fully decentralized, which is a good thing as well. The second thing that was very important, and that's one of the reasons why we jumped into the ecosystem as well, it's because, you know, in Europe, Tezos is pretty powerful, at least as a powerful corporate ecosystem. And that's very important to gain extra, you know, brands or traction with maybe corporates and all these corporations, you know, that are big players of our industries and need to have solution like us, plug and play. And the story is easy to write for us. So that's the reason why, I mean, for those two reasons, we picked, you know, the Tezos blockchain, beside the fact that it was the first blockchain as well that gave us a lot of confidence on our product and, you know, helped us, you know, develop it. So, yeah, that's important. Yeah.
Okay. And as I mentioned earlier, we'll be giving away some Lyzi tokens today.
Yeah.
Can you talk a little bit about what the Lyzi token is and how it fits into all of this?
Yeah, sure. Our Lyzi token is, I used to call it like this. I used to call it this platform token. It's, you know, I used to say a BNB-like or a Crow-like from crypto.com. It got different utilities and use cases, of course, mainly based on bringing a new usage. So it's more based on this cashback thing, you know, regarding, you know, when you do the payment, you have cashback in return with the Lyzi token, but as well as loyalty, incentive. You know, what's important for us is to generate usage, you know, because brands are looking for this usage, you know. So our mission for us is to, I mean, to drive adoption. To drive adoption, you need to find the right way, you know, to drive growth, you know. So cashback is one of the options. All the incentive we can have around the tokens, of course. You can use it as well for payment purposes, as you can use it as well for DeFi, for example. We love the DeFi on Tezos, even though it's a bit low right now. But we have a lot of different use cases on the Tezos DeFi, for example, on Plenty or on KipuSwap as well, which is a good thing. As well as, you know, buyback and burn, for example, on every transaction fees we are collecting. We have a piece of it that is going to buyback and burn. So yeah, it's a lot of different utilities. If we have to put pillars on it, first pillar will be incentive. The second one will be DeFi, and the third one will be let's call it, you know, burn and buyback, but it's more to have it the nicest possible. Yeah.
Okay. Can you explain the relationship between the Lyzi token and Tez? How do the two tokens interact?
Yeah, I mean, for now, they are mainly working together in this, you know, DeFi ecosystem, which is very important for us. Maybe, at least, you know, for tomorrow, I mean, what we plan in our roadmap is to have it more, to bring more interactions, you know, between those two tokens, because that's very important to have them together to drive growth. Because, you know, if we have like strong use cases, if we have us, you know, more Lyzi holders, token holders, we're going to have more usage, we're going to have more product usage, which is very important. And it's also very important to have Tez token, you know, into our ecosystem, because that will bring us some extra users, which is very important, you know, as you understand. So yeah, we have a double challenge on that. It's to make our token leave the easiest way possible, you know, with our community and with our users, as well as we have to drive growth with this Tezos ecosystem, with people that got Tez and want to jump with us, maybe to experiment, maybe at first DeFi with staking, with farming or whatever, and tomorrow with payment and cashback and loyalty. Yeah, that's how we see it actually.
So obviously, onboarding merchants to accept crypto payments is a massively important step toward making Lyzi work. What kind of progress has your team made in connecting with brands and retailers and merchants and getting them to accept crypto payments so far?
Yeah, actually, we have a lot of growth on that, a lot of traction. In 1 year, we've been signing more than 1,000 shops accepting crypto payment in France, Belgium, and in Spain. So without making a lot of business development effort, I will say, however, you know, we were mainly focused on those indirect integration. So what we were looking for, it was mainly based on these PSPs or POS system integration, because they are keys in the model we are building right now. Because, you know, when you go and see, for example, a Target center tomorrow in the US, you know, this Target, Target centers, yeah. If you go there and you want to deploy crypto payment in their legacy cashier system, for example, you're going to have to be integrated before even talking to them, you know. So the strategy for us is to push towards, you know, all those type of integration to be the easiest way possible when we deal with them, you know, with this plug and play solution. So usually when we go and see, you know, a brand, we are already integrated in the POS system or Android payment terminal. So that makes it a lot easier when you deal, you know, with the IT or the DAF or whatever, you know, because, you know, everything is already done and it's just plug and play. You know, they don't have any other questions. Basically, we are integrated. You activate the toggle, we do the KYC, and that's it, it's done. You can accept crypto payments. So it's very important to have it done. For the next step that are very important is to build something a bit more global. I told you we are mainly based on the European market, mainly French, Belgium, and Spain, but we want to expand, you know, our solution worldwide. That's why we built, by the way, our crypto hub, which is a white label solution, to be a little bit more global and to go in countries where we don't have merchants so far. So yeah, so this indirect integration is key for us. So that's how we see, you know, like the future, building a lot of other integrations, and that will drive a lot of growth on our end. Yes, for sure.
And when you approach these merchants to have that conversation, obviously from a technical standpoint, you're saying it's a pretty easy sell, that it's plug and play, that it's relatively simple on their end. But is this something that merchants already feel like they need to do to get into Web3 kind of payment systems? Or is that something that you need to convince them of?
It depends. Sometimes you have like some merchants that are more mature than some others, you know, but you know, when you tell me this, you know, I just remember when I was in, when we were in 2018, 19, you know, and when we were dealing with big corporates, you know, I mean, we were so far away from what they thought of the market, the how it could fit, what was the blockchain technology and so on, you know. So I feel like the corporates and the brands are really mature on those topics, you know. I thought with the beer market, all Web3 projects will be killed. And it was not the case, actually. They believe in one thing, you know, they had a lot of experimentation regarding this loyalty thing, this NFT thing, you know, during the previous bull market. With this up and down thing, you know, NFTs were, in my opinion, you know, like, it was, you know, like in 2021, this market was a bit crazy and the use cases around NFTs were not stronger as they should be, you know. Mm-hmm. However, you know, I believe that with brands still building on those topics, we're going to have a lot of different use cases and powerful use cases around NFTs as loyalty, as well as crypto payment. Because when you do as a first step crypto payment, basically it's easy for you to onboard users for the NFT card membership, for example, you know. So that's why it's very important, you know, when I told you at the very beginning that this omnichannelity thing is very important, means that once I got and I know that this end user is a Web3 player, then, you know, we have a lot of gamification, a thing we can push to him because for sure we love them, you know. So it's just segmentation for brands, you know. And I used to give this example, you know, in France, for example, we have like, we deploy in December, Printemps. Printemps is one of the biggest mall player, you know, in the ecosystem. Let's call it the French retail ecosystem. They have big malls all over France. They have one in New York City as well as Abu Dhabi. And, you know, for them, the strategy around payment is pretty easy. You know, in 2017-16, they deploy, for example, Alipay and WeChat Pay in their legacy cashier, you know. Mm. It's not for you and me. It's just when you have Asian people that use, you know, those type of payment solution in their home countries, you know, when they come here to visit Paris, we just fit with the payment method they use in their daily lives. So that's the strategy they are all having right now. So we feel it's a lot of growth on that. And, you know, we have something extra that is coming in Paris in a couple of months in France. Actually, it's the Olympics with a lot of travelers. And, you know, we feel like it's something happening with brands because they want to be able to talk to all those people coming to our country, you know. And crypto payment is one of the these options, you know. At least, you know, it will be experimentation for some of them. Some of them are totally confident with it. You know, Printemps, for example, it was not an experimentation. They said, okay, I want that. I want to deploy it everywhere. So, you know, we made it 100%. Some retailers want to do it step by step. First, you do your experimentation, your pilot, and then you do the integration and blah, blah, blah. So, yeah. But we feel like something is happening right now. Yeah. I mean, definitely. Yeah.
Now that it's been deployed with some retailers, what has the response been like from users and from merchants?
Yeah. I mean, we have to convince, in this Western pound, I mean, we are in the Western pound of the world, which is, you know, like, we have pretty much access to everything, you know, all the Web3 users actually in France, in Europe, or even in the US usually use it for speculation purposes, unfortunately. But the pain point is to be able to re-inject those crypto into the real economy, which is a pain point and it's tough. However, you know, we need to create this usage with Web3 users because they need to know and they need to have solutions easy to play with, where they can, you know, not struggle when they want to off-ramp, you know, their token into the real economy or when they want to pay with it. So That's why we believe that what we are doing as a payment infrastructure will be a game changer for the next 10 years, for sure, because we target to have 1 billion users in the industry. That's what's the target we are having before 2029, I think. We're going to have 1 billion users in the Web3 space, which is huge. And brands need to be able to attract those people, to talk to those people, you know. So, you know, like our solution is no-brainer for them because, you know, we are the gap, the bridge between those two population that don't know how to talk to each other right now. So we are this bridge to make it happen, actually. Yeah.
So in order to use the Lyzi platform, I'm told users need to download the Lyzi app, correct?
For now, yeah. For now, but we're changing, yeah.
So for now, for those who are curious and want to have a look, want to experiment, where can they find the Lyzi app and what do they need to do to get started?
Yeah, I mean, it's plug and play. Basically, you download the app and then you connect the exchange available. I mean, the COX you used to, I mean, that is connected, you know, and you connect it to your Lyzi app, and that's pretty much it. You can start to spend your crypto with Lyzi app. However, we are changing a bit our product and moving to this B2B thing where we are more a connector than just an app for the end users because, you know, I told you we learned a lot about the market. We had a lot of different experimentation on the market. So our first product was, I think, terrific, but that's how it is. We learned a lot about it. And we improved it, you know, we came up with a KYC, then we said, no, KYC is so much, I mean, so much churn, it's not just not possible. So we started to connect exchanges in the app, and I think it's the good vision, right thing to do. However, you know, this download the app could be a pain point. So now what we are going to do is just connecting, you know, those platform with our merchant ecosystem. And for the end user, it will be even more easier. So basically, you have your crypto.com or Binance account, and you will just pay directly with your Binance account or crypto.com account, and maybe tomorrow some other, you know, players that are coming directly at the cashier, actually. So it will be plug and play and very global. As we are going to have as well this year, this not custodial thing is coming up because, of course, you know, the technology is a bit more mature. At that time, you know, in 2018, when I told you about Easy Wallet, you know, we had the seed phrase that was tough to handle for the majority of the people, except the crypto holders that were used to have, you know, this type of usage. However, you know, like the market, I feel, is a bit more mature on those. We have new technologies coming up, you know, with wallet abstraction and all those type of solution that can be integrated in our payment stack as a plug-and-play solution. So we're going to have this non-custodial thing. We believe Etherlink as well will be a game changer in the ecosystem with Tezos. That's very important to bridge those Tezos ecosystem, but with the Ethereum, you know, ecosystem. That's important because a lot of things happen there. What we want for now is continuing to develop, you know, this crypto payment hub as a white label gate payment gateway, and add, you know, new features such as payment with non-custodial wallet, plug and play. That's really what we want. You know, I think I said it already 10 times in the interview, but that's really key for us to make things easy for the end user as it should be as well for the merchant. So that's the challenge for us.
This is all great stuff so far. I'm excited to learn more. But before we dive into the nitty-gritty, are you ready for the world-famous TezTalks lightning round?
Yeah, let's do that. It's fun.
Great. Just before we do that, I'd like to announce today's keyword for the 4,000 Lyzi token prize packs we're giving away today. Today's keyword is !Lyzi, L-Y-Z-I. Enter the keyword !Lyzi. Below this video on X, and Nightbot will randomly select today's winner, who will announce in the comments below this video on X as well. Okay, now, Damien, it's lightning round time. Remember, there are no wrong answers. This is just for fun, so our viewers can get to know you a little bit better. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Let's do that.
Cats or dogs?
Cats.
Pizza or sushi?
Sushi.
Movies or video games?
Movies.
Is this real life or are we in a simulation?
I believe real life. I prefer real life.
True or false? Money buys happiness.
Pretty false.
Name one thing you absolutely want to do before you die.
Will be climbing the Everest.
Wow.
Yeah.
The last place you traveled was?
I think it was in Greece, actually. Greece.
Very, very nice. In five words or less, how would your best friend describe you?
Hard worker. I five words. Hard worker, resilient, and happy.
Beautiful. Finally, what is your favorite thing to do on a rainy day?
Workout.
Very nice. Thank you. Those were excellent answers. This concludes the TEZ Talks Lightning Round. Let's get back into it. Now that we've introed Lyzi, I'd like to zoom out a little bit and talk about the state of crypto payments more generally. This obviously isn't the first time that we've heard about a brand looking to make crypto payments in retail a thing. And I'm curious, what do you think the problem has been that's prevented this type of platform from reaching its sort of mass adoption moment so far?
Actually, you know, like the onboarding is key. You know, like make products easy to play with is absolutely key. I think, you know, like we have a world with two different visions. Vision number one that we are all in the Western part of the world is to get off this speculation thing. That's very important. That's one of the main topic, you know, because if we want to have like crypto payment usage, we need to go a little bit away of this only speculation thing, you know, I mean. So this is the part of this northern part of the world, you know, but in the other part of the world, you know, we have people that don't have access, you know, to any payment technology, banking systems, and so. And I believe that, you know, crypto payment will be a game changer, you know, for that, because all those people will go from nothing to pretty much everything, you know, which is very important without having a bank or without having, you know, like, people that will go for heavy devaluation of their national currencies and so on, you know. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I mean, we need to find, you know, the right the writing. You know, we see it anyway. Places in the world where you have the biggest, you know, volumes regarding crypto payments are in countries where you have issues with their national currencies, you know, with high devaluation and all this inflation thing, you know, which that can be very high. And, you know, people go for that because, you know, it's a way of saving the money they have, you know, which is very important. So, yeah, if we want to have massive usage, we need to be able to have this, once again, plug and play product. That's very important. We need to onboard people the easiest way possible. That's why I told you the wallet abstraction technology is very important, because that will bring a lot of different use cases with crypto payment, as well as maybe banking tomorrow system. I mean, it can be a lot of different things, you know, it's different use cases. And, you know, like as far as the time is pushing on, you know, like technology is getting a bit more mature and mature, which is important. As it is important as well, when we talk about payment, I told you it's very challenging for the end user, and everyone loves to have this tap and pay thing, you know, when you pay with your cell phone. What's important for us as a payment infrastructure, I mean, tomorrow's payment infrastructure, is to have, you know, like scalability, which is very important, because, you know, we talk a lot about Visa, MasterCard, but they process a lot of transactions. That's very important, you know, and if you want to be able to proceed, you know, a lot of transactions, you need to have like a strong technology. And we believe that, you know, like the technology is getting more mature. And we need to bring use cases now with this global acceptance and usage. That's why I believe, you know, and that's why we build this crypto payment hub, because, traction today, you know, around crypto payment is mainly in other parts of the world than the one we are dealing with right now, you know. So we need to experiment in those areas, and we believe it will be game changer in the area where we're gonna you know, deliver the product actually.
Okay. And you mentioned that there are other parts of the world where these things have become more appealing due to issues with their local currency, issues with access to the banking system, access to digital types of payments. How have advancements in the technology underpinning blockchain and crypto made things more doable from a practical standpoint? Can you talk a bit more about that?
I mean, what we are building, you know, we believe, for example, that, you know, QR code payment technology, you know, is a game changer, you know, in the ecosystem. Why? Because this gives us the opportunity to have other payment routes. If you have other payment routes, that means you can change things. If you still stick, you know, with the same payment routes as the one we are using in our daily lives with credit card, debit cards, American Express cards, or whatever, you know, it will be tough, you know, to move forward, you know, maybe a new world or give access to other way of using technologies or new use cases. So that's very important, you know, to have like this technology able, you know, to be able, you know, to reach this global audience that needs to have it, you know, because, you know, a lot of people, as I said, you know, don't have even access to this banking system, payment system. They don't know how to deal with it. They don't even have access to it. And tomorrow, on behalf of blockchain technology, QR code payment technology, non-custodial wallet, even though you're going to have this wallet abstraction, they're going to be able to have pretty much everything on their end. And that's very important because that will change things globally.
So you just mentioned QR code payments, which I'm quite curious about. Can you just tell us what QR code payments are and how they work?
Yeah, basically QR code payment, you know, they give us the opportunity to put pretty much everything in the, you know, the QR code you have. Usually, you know, it's a lot of information. So the QR code is just a way to send information, actually, you know, to the right routes or to different routes, actually. So for us, you know, like everything starts with the QR code. We saw the usages of the QR code increasing with the COVID-19. Unfortunately, I will say for COVID-19, but you know, the QR code technology exists since years now. I think it's maybe even decades. However, you know, it was a few usages, except in Asia, for example, or, you know, like areas in the world where, you know, it was a bit more mature. And I believe that this technology will give us the opportunity to do pretty much everything we need and we want regarding those payment routes and access to different, you know, banking systems. You know, for example, in Europe or even in the US, it's more or less the same, but we already have like rails, you know, payment rails. So usually, you know, when you are regular payment provider, actually, you know, you have payment rails already existing. You just connect to those rails and everything is okay. You know, it's a straight line. What we are building right now is something a bit different where we use other routes and other rails, which is different. And this QR code technology is the start of this, you know, so that's very important to have it. That's why we are accelerating the pace regarding that, even though it can be tough sometimes because as we talk about the merchant, for example, at the very beginning, you know, we need to also have people digitalized, you know, to be able to use it, you know. And for example, if you take this use case with merchants, usually merchants, you know, display QR code. So they push it to the, you know, the screen you are having at the cashier, you know, and you scan it. So that's a pretty easy use case to deal with. However, that means that we need to be integrated. That's why I told you sometimes it can be hard because routes and rails are totally different of the traditional payment method actually. Yeah.
And I understand that Lyzi transactions currently are settled with merchants using fiat currencies.
Yeah.
What are you doing to make settling some of these transactions using crypto assets more appealing?
Very good question. You know, I told you we learned a lot from the market, actually. And as you asked me a bit previously in the interview, what's the main concern brands have when we talk about crypto payment? The number one is how you guarantee me that 100 euros paid in Bitcoin, for example, is 100 euros at the end of the day and not 120 one day or 80 the other day. So that was one of the biggest pain points we have to face here in Europe, actually, with merchants that want to have this guarantee of turnover, you know. So that's why we decided to go for this full off-ramping. So when you pay in Bitcoin in one of our merchants, they are fully settled in euros right now or any local currency, basically. However, you know, we have merchants requesting this feature, and some merchants wants to have maybe a settlement, you know, as, 10% in crypto and 19% in fiat, for example. And we are working on this feature to give them the opportunity to go after, you know, for treasury management, earnings and everything. That could be a good use case for DeFi, for example, on Tezos, for example. And but we need to go step by step. The first step for us is to go to deploy the solution plug and play. They have transactions. They receive the money on the bank accounts. That's very important. So we build trust. Once we have trust, we can go as a second step in those things, you know, so the NFT card membership, tomorrow the treasury management with earnings on it, for example, on the DeFi and everything. So it's a step-by-step thing. However, you know, with the crypto payment hub, we believe that, you know, like merchants in areas of the world, for example, where the local currency is pretty devaluated, they will prefer to have 100% settled in crypto rather than to have it in the fiat, you know. So maybe I should come back within 9 or 12 months and I will give you feedback on that, because I'm sure we'll have a lot of learnings on that. Yeah.
Okay. What's next for the Lyzi team? Do you have any other exciting announcements or rollouts in the works?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of things going on, actually. We are launching a new COX in our payment gate in the next few days, weeks. I know it's a bit long for our community, but it takes time to integrate all those players, you know, with our payment technology stack, you know, because it's not about only QR code technology. We'll also have this e-commerce thing, you know, with plugins and everything. So, you know, it's tricky to integrate a new COX. So we are launching one in a couple of weeks, days, weeks. This way is better. And we are closing as well our raising. We are raising fund right now as a seed stage. We should be done by the end of April, probably before. But we are halfway of it, actually. And it's going pretty well. So we are pretty happy of it. And we are preparing, above all, you know, the launch of a lot of new brands, because we need to be ready for the Olympics in July. So a lot of things are going on right now. And I'm sure before the next 6 months will be heavy in news, actually. So it will be great. Yeah.
It'll be great. I could ask you 1,000 more questions. Like, obviously, I feel like it's a hugely important use case and it's a very interesting topic, but we are running out of time and we're almost at the end here. And before we close off, I'd like to remind our viewers that we're giving away 4 prize packages containing 2,000 Lyzi tokens each today. To enter, just type the keyword LYZI in the comments below this video on X. For those who miss out today, we remind you that there are awesome giveaways to be found frequently here on Tez Talks Live, so keep tuning in. If you'd like to get in touch with us, our social media contacts can be found at tezoscommons.org/teztalks. We'd love to hear from you. Damien, thanks so much for joining us today. It's always awesome to speak to the folks enabling the blockchain-powered financial system of the future and keeping Tezos at the forefront of the Web3 revolution. Is there anything else you'd like to mention before we sign off?
No, once again, I want to thank you for the invitation. It was a great time. For the people that are watching, listening, please follow us. That's important. Give us some power. And that's just the first step. I don't have anything anymore to say. And once again, thank you to all the TezTalks community as well. And hopefully I talk to you in 9 to 12 months to give you yes. some feedback regarding, you know, this.
Let's do it.
Yeah, this merchant settlement. Yeah.
To everyone out there in Tezos land, thanks for joining us on the TezTalks Live. I'm Stu from the Tezos Commons, and our awesome guest has been Damien Patero, founder and CEO of Lyzi. Now let's go shopping.
That's a good thing.